us observe the five first Saturdays as Our Lady of Fatima requested. This devotion consists of four parts, all of which should be made in a spirit of making reparation for blasphemies and ingratitude, and for peace in the world. First of all, to go to confession, generally within 8 days before or after the first Saturday of the month. Second, to receive Holy Communion on the first Saturday of the month. Third, to recite five decades of the Holy Rosary. And fourth, to meditate for 15 minutes on the mysteries of the Holy Rosary. So please join us coming up next for the Daily Mass and our EWTN family First Saturday devotions.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood,
Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Christ,
us pray. Almighty God, you made Saint Joseph of Leonissa an illustrious preacher of the gospel. Through his prayers, inflame us with love and with his zeal for souls, that we may serve you alone. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, through Jesus, let us continually offer God a sacrifice of praise. That is, the fruit of lips that confess his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have. God is pleased by sacrifices of that kind. Obey your leaders and defer to them, for they keep watch over you and will have to give an account, that they may fulfill their task with joy and not with sorrow, for that would be of no advantage to you. May the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, Jesus our Lord, furnish you with all that is good, that you may do his will. May he carry out in you what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Verbum Domini.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me, he refreshes my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me in right paths, for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side, with your rod and your staff, they give me courage.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You spread the table before me, in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Marcum.
Gloria in Domine.
The apostles gathered together with Jesus and reported all they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while." People were coming and going in great numbers, and they had no opportunity even to eat. So they went off in the boat by themselves to a deserted place. People saw them leaving, and many came to know about it. They hastened there on foot from all the towns and arrived at the place before them. When Jesus disembarked and saw the vast crowd, his heart was moved with pity for them, for they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things.
Verbum Domini.
Image of the heart of God in the gospel passage today. Jesus disembarked and saw the vast crowd. His heart was moved with pity. In this circumstance, most of us would not be jumping up and down for joy to see these people. These are the same people on the other side of the lake. You know, he was dealing with them, and as St. Mark said, they barely had enough time or an opportunity even to eat. And so they are going away, and crossing that lake, they say, would take about four hours. But if the wind wasn't blowing in the right direction, it would take a bit longer. And the people on foot could go around and in a little bit under 10 hours get to the other side and meet you. And that's what happened, that here they're disembarking and looking at the same set of people who are just needing. Most of us would get a bit annoyed. You know, if the ideal thing is that we come from this situation where, you know, they have gone to rest, they've been alone, they've eaten, and then they step out of the boat and ready to go. But they're tired. Jesus is tired. I think that's important for us to remember. He became man. Even though he was this divine person, he took a share in our human nature. And so he felt the same fatigue, the same tiredness that every one of us does. And we need time to be alone. This is where we see God at work, though, that in looking at the people, he realized those who were to be guiding them were not guiding them, and that they were completely lost. If you imagine yourself in the dark and it's raining and you have no idea where you are, and they had no sense of direction as to where to go, that's where we see Christ's compassion for them, sheep without a shepherd. They would surely be lost. And so they were seeking direction, a course to take in their life, and it was to follow him ultimately. He's the one that would give them the direction they needed to go in. I could about imagine what it would be like to read the minds of the apostles when they stepped off onto the shore. It would be like reading every one of our minds. And I'm sure their thoughts were not the most charitable. And yet when they looked at the action of Christ, they knew what the action of the church would be. They knew what their apostolic ministry would look like. That souls are constantly in need of Christ, his teaching, and the direction of life that he provides for us. And so the mission of the church is one that is tireless, and that manifests this pity of the heart of our Savior. The first part of the gospel, however, is what I want to focus our attention on, that Jesus
did in fact say to the apostles, and he meant this, come away by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while. And I'm sure that there were moments in their ministry and working side by side with Christ and living those 3 years with him during his public ministry, that they did go apart and spend that time alone and rest. And it speaks to us of the importance of the rhythm of the Christian life, that we all need to have that time where we go and spend time apart. If we don't, then we will come apart. You know, Jesus says, come apart and rest a while. He doesn't say, you know, literally come apart. If we don't have that time alone with him, our life will go to pieces. If any one of you or any of our viewers or listeners feels like their life is a total chaos and they're coming unglued, a large part of what we need to do and that our world wants to prevent us from, or what the enemy wants to prevent us from, is taking that time to be alone with the Lord and spending that necessary time in silence. When we don't have that, life begins not to make sense, and we begin to be like these sheep who are just terrified or meandering around and stuck at a fork in the road and not knowing where to go, utterly lost. And so this speaks to us of the rhythm of the Christian life, the life of prayer and action, or the contemplative active dimensions of the Christian life. If we look at natural life alone, there's a time for rest and a time for activity, a time for work and a time to sleep. And one is not good if the other is not adequate. And so if our whole life is one of leisure, just kind of sitting around and I'm not putting forth any work, there's no activity in my life, I don't sleep well. But if I invest myself in a engaged in something that's engaging my mind and my body throughout the day, I go to bed tired and I sleep and I get a good night's rest. Likewise, if I don't sleep enough, if I have a sleeping disorder, or if I don't give myself adequate amount of time to sleep, again, isn't this the way of our world? Keeping us busy, 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 and everybody's trying to, live in these cities that never sleep, as they say. And we're supposed to be impressed by that. Washington, D.C., New York City, the city that never sleeps. You know, that's a big lie. And look at, this chaos of what that looks like. And we are to take time to sleep. I mean, we feel like we get in this mode on a natural level that if I only sleep for 3 hours or 4 hours, the rest of the time I'm just working away. That's not virtuous. The Lord designed us in our natural life, our natural body, to have this rhythm. There's a time that we work, there's a time that we recreate, there's a time that we rest. And when all of that is in a proper balance, there's a harmony in our life and good health that results from that. And that's the same thing that's true of the Christian life, that if we want to be healthy in the Christian life, there's a time that we are to do and a time that we are to be. And that's what Jesus was inviting these disciples to do. Come away by yourselves to a deserted place, rest a while, stop doing, and just be. And when we take a time throughout the year to go on retreat, or our parishes offer a day of recollection, or we simply take a day out to say, well, I'm going to spend this time with my family, with those that I love, and I'm going to shut out all the activity of the distraction of the world. And a time for us, an opportunity for us to literally exist. I think many of us don't do this. That when we, even when we say, well, I'm going to go to pray, we're still in the driver's seat. We're still telling the Lord how everything's supposed to be. Okay, Lord, this is what I need you to do. And then this is going to happen, and then that's going to happen, and then everything's going to be perfect. Okay, go. That's what we say to the Lord. And what he wants us to do is to sit still and to recognize that we're his son, we're his daughter, we're his child, that we're loved by him, that he made us and that he loves us. And it's embracing that, or sitting in that reality, that that's what it means to be. And that's when we grow in our relationship with him, and we're given the grace and the strength then to do, to carry out his will and to be active members and active participants in his mission. So both of these are necessary. The Christian that never exercises the grace given to him or her, the Christian that never does anything, is also not going to be healthy in the spiritual life. We call that spiritual gluttony. And it's just like just sitting there, you know, sucking everything in. It has to be exercised through a life of charity. So there does have to be activity in the life of the Christian, an effort and a conscious effort to do good. But I think in our time, it's the other that is usually wanting. Most of us, when we stop telling the Lord what to do, then we say, well, okay, now what should I do? I'm ready to always be active and engaged. And so to be part of the church means I'm helping to run bingo, and I'm serving the luncheon at the funerals, and I'm helping operate the auction for the parish. All those things are good. And we all are to be participants in that. But we still miss the opportunity, we still miss the point, the invitation of the Lord, who says, come and just be with me. And that's what he was inviting the disciples to do. You know, they had gone and reported all that they had done and taught. And that's what Jesus was saying. Let's go apart, let's go aside, you rest, and just share with me what that experience was. Tell me what you taught. Tell me what you saw. And just be in my presence. This is the transformative power of prayer, to be in the Lord's presence. Sometimes parents conclude with this. Many times parents ask us what they can do to help their children. And one of the best things, I think we can use the word mortification, and also look at this passage in the proper light. To say to young people, you know, we have all of this media, our iPhones, our iPads, our music, our, you know, texting and messaging, and, you know, the young people don't even use Facebook. That's something for senior citizens now. Ha, 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 you know, but young people are constantly engaged with each other and with people. The one thing that those of us who are older look at young people and say, they're engaged with the whole world, but they never talk to anyone. They're chatting with everyone, but never communicating with anyone. And they wonder why, we wonder why our youth feel so alienated, so alone, so desolate in this world. And the importance is to help our young people understand. And when we say mortification, everybody cringes. We think, oh no, they're going to take away all my food. I'm not going to eat anything. That's what they're saying, mortification. When the church says mortification, you're not going to eat for 3 months straight. You know, or you have to sleep, take away your pillow, you sleep with your head on a rock. nor we're going to give you a little whip, and you're going to scourge yourself. And we read this in the lives of saints. But mortification is, we can take this discipline upon ourselves, and it's for our benefit, for our good. It's ultimately, it's a means to greater union with Christ. So the mortification for young people today is to put the phone on silence and set it over there for 20 minutes, for half an hour. Shut the TV off, leave the music off. You will survive if you're not in communication with someone for 30 minutes. And yes, is that a discipline? Is that a sacrifice? It certainly feels that way at the beginning. But we can willfully do this and freely do this and put that aside with the intention of saying, I'm going to give the Lord this next 20 minutes, this next 30 minutes, to just be with Him, and to just sit in the silence and experience what that's like, because it's in that moment of silence that He will speak to me. And that's the invitation for every one of us. It's the invitation especially for our young people, for the sake of their sanity and the sake of their salvation. You say this often to young people who are on college campuses. There's some place on a campus, whether it's a Catholic or religious affiliated campus, or even just a secular state campus, there's some place where you can go and be quiet. You know, go out up on some hillside, or go into some, you know, academic building that is not in use for a class period, and just sit down and just put yourself in God's presence and follow that invitation. Come away by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while, and let Him speak to you, to your heart, and you'll find that you speak to Him heart to heart. This heart that is manifest as one that is moved with such tremendous pity and compassion for us. And trust, we offer our petitions.
That the Church may rejoice in the boundless mercy of God, which has achieved our salvation, and celebrate the glory that has been bestowed upon us in Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the lay faithful may have the courage and generosity to take on increasing responsibility for the Church's works of education and evangelization, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may not be afraid to be faithful to Jesus' teaching on the dignity of human life, even if our faithfulness causes some to separate from us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase in vocations to the priesthood and the consecrated life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may rest in peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we again entrust ourselves and all of our needs to you. We pray in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
Oh, Jesus, joy of loving hearts, thou fount of life, thou life of men, from the best bliss that earth imparts, we turn unfilled to thee again. Thy truth unchanged hath ever stood, thou savest
Sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all his holy church.
Almighty God, look with favor on the gifts we offer you. Grant that our hearts may ever be inflamed by the mystery of the Lord's sufferings, even as Saint Joseph experienced their sacred marks in his body. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Tecum spiritus tuo.
Sursum corda.